everyone. Welcome to this week's office time with me. This has been really a really great experience connecting with a lot of you over the last couple of months during this weekly live office time. As those of you who've been participating in the past know, I answer questions and also talk about topics that are very specifically focused on scaling your business. And when I say scaling your business, what I mean, scaling your business past $1 million in annual revenue. These are kinds of focus areas that I talk about. And I appreciate those of you who've been joining me over the last couple of months. And I see Elsa. Oh, hi, Elsa. Nice to see you. And I believe it's Ina. Nice to see you. Today I actually wanted to talk about an important topic when it's about scaling your business, and in particular focusing on subtracting. And the reason I say that is because this actually came up in one of my companies this week. And as some of you know, I own several companies. And it came up because an individual on one of my teams said, oh, I've been really busy and I haven't been able to do this task in the last 2 months. It's, you know, as you know, that task is really time consuming. And then I stopped him and I said, wait a minute. I said, you know what? That task is no longer relevant. It's no longer relevant to the stage of the business that we're in. And if it weren't for the fact that he had brought that up, it wouldn't have even occurred to me whether or not he was even doing it, frankly, because it had slipped my mind that he had been doing this particular task. And what I realized is that here he has this mental reminder, and it's kind of in the back of his mind, I have to do that, I have to do that, and I haven't gotten to it. And it's very time consuming, quite honestly. And Malin, nice to see you too. it reminded me of a very important lesson I learned at a Stanford program about scaling your business a couple of years ago. And that is, to scale, you periodically have to evaluate things that you and your team members are doing. So look at rituals, look at actually roles in the organization, look at things such as types of meetings that you have, products that you have, or services and solutions that you're providing that may no longer be relevant. And in fact, not only no longer relevant, but they can be an energy drain. They can stop people from doing things that are very important and important for you to scale. So another example would be, you know, when you're a smaller company, it might make sense that you have frequent all hands meetings on a regular basis. But there might come a time, and you might already be there, where you have to say, boy, is this really the most effective way for us to communicate? We're bigger. Is it really possible to maintain the connectedness and the engagement with all of our employees because they're now a bigger company? Maybe we need to restructure a little bit and have weekly departmental or group meetings, and maybe have our all-hands meeting once a month. All of this is simply to say is that it is important and strategic if you periodically look at the roles in your organization, as well as the responsibilities, the tasks, the rituals, the things that have just you've been doing from the beginning, and find and assess whether or not they're still relevant, and most important, are they getting in the way of you being able to scale your company? So my point today is really about, to scale, sometimes you have to subtract. Now, next week I'll talk about, to scale, sometimes you need to add, but I wanted to focus on that. And especially now as, you know, there are opportunities in this middle of this pandemic for a lot of companies, if you're strategically thinking about that. So when you're thinking about scaling, we're focused on scaling. So it's easy to kind of get into this habit or this rote of routines and things that you're doing. And it's important to perhaps look at things on a yearly basis or a quarterly basis, depending on what makes the most sense, and just to reevaluate. And the other thing I would suggest is, often it's your team members that are doing the day-to-day roles in the organizations that could be the ones who could give you guidance. You just have to prompt them for it. So you might initiate a conversation where you ask your team leads or members of different divisions or departments in your company, and you say, is there a task, role, or something that we're doing that you think perhaps we shouldn't be doing any longer, or we can do it better, or we should implement a process improvement? By the way, I learned that from our client Toyota. Toyota's been one of my company clients for many, many years, and if you know anything about their philosophy, they have a Kaizen philosophy, Japanese philosophy about process improvement. So take the opportunity to elicit ideas and input from your team members. And they may not be thinking about it, but if you pose the question, they may say, you know, we've been doing this XYZ for the last 3 years, but given where our clients are, our customers are, and what they need, I don't think that's really relevant anymore. And in fact, we should be doing something else. So to scale, subtract. Now, I wanted to answer a question that has come up frequently in the last few weeks, which is about how did I learn all this about scaling businesses past $1 million in annual revenue? And I keep saying that because there are a great percentage of certainly women-owned businesses as well as minority-owned businesses. When I say a high percentage, meaning over 85%, that are generating less than $1 million in annual revenue. Now, candidly, some may want to have a lifestyle business, as we call a lifestyle business or a smaller business, but many would like to scale past $1 million. And there are any number of different reasons and challenges why that is often difficult, especially for women. So I learned a lot of what I do and scaling my businesses through not only now having my third business, but in addition to that, participating in various types of executive management and leadership, and in particular, a program through the Stanford Latino Scaling Initiative. And if you want to know more about that, look up LBAN, L-B-A-N, L-B as in boy, A-N as in Nancy. And that course, which was over 6 weeks at Stanford, was all about scaling your businesses, and so unique. So I learned a lot of this from programs like that. So that's how I'm now able to share the tips and advice and things that I share with you all on a weekly basis. And I do this as part of my program called Possibility Architect. And the title for that, Possibility Architect, is because throughout my life, I've architected all of my possibilities, especially the great ones. And so I'm a firm believer that you have the ability to architect the business that you want and the life that you want. And I developed that program because I've been asked many, many times, can I mentor someone? And I have felt bad because I have numerous companies. It's very hard for me to be able to dedicate that one-on-one time. And that's how I came up with my program called Possibility Architect. So if you want to learn more, you can check it out at possibilityarchitect.com. I have a free masterclass there, which will give you a greater indication of the weekly online mentoring program that I have. I wish you much success, that you all continue to stay healthy, stay strong, and that you are able to have a restorative and peaceful time ahead. See you next week.